spectrum, the game's theoretical approach to strategy generation for moving target difference in web applications.
Thanks for coming to the talk. I'm sure you guys are hungry. I'll try to keep the presentation interesting, if not necessarily short. So I'm from Arizona State University. This is a joint collaborative work with Dr. Subhara Kamapati's lab and the cybersecurity lab at ASU. So when we talk about web application security, you would notice that in a recent few years, there has been a lot of instances where web applications have been compromised. Now, why is it so? In most cases, it's not that difficult a problem. You pick out a web application which has a single system. You spend some time finding a vulnerability. You figure out how to attack that system, and you attack. Now, as a notion of security, this is Muhammad Ali doing moving target defense, by the way. So as a notion of security, notion of moving target defense has come into web applications. So what this essentially does is that instead of having a single web stack application, you have multiple ones. And you keep switching between these multiple web stack configurations. So the attacker who has devised an attack for one of your web stack applications cannot actually land an attack because you have shifted. Now the question is, in cybersecurity systems, people like to use a random strategy. They believe this increases the entropy of such systems. Now the question is random strategy the best kind of switching strategy that you can do for these kind of systems? Well, the answer is no. If it was yes, I wouldn't have a paper here. So when we want to design a strategy for these kind of systems, we have to account for something. An attacker So a web application is deployed for a long amount of time. So an attacker can actually do probing attacks on your system, finally figuring out what kind of configurations you have, and also a probability value over the infinite amount of time step if your web application stays up for infinite time. So we have to account for this and strategically design a defense mechanism or defense strategy to counteract this. So we will now design a normal form repeated game in which we have two players. One is a defender, who is the system admin. One is an attacker, who is a real-time attacker. We'll define these more and some rewards. So first, let's talk about what actions a defender has. So to a defender, he has a web application system that can use a coding language and a database. It's a simple one. And here, for just a small example, we use two applications. So the same application works with PHP as the coding language and MySQL as the database. And in the second case, Python as the coding language and PostgreSQL as the database. And the X vector that we denote here is essentially the probability with which you're going to select the first configuration, and X2 is the one with which you're going to select the next configuration. Obviously, it's possible to use PHP and PostgreSQL and Python and MySQL, increasing the action sets for the defender, but we won't go there. Now let's talk about the attacker. So when we talk about attack actions, where are we going to get these from the real world? So there is a database called the National Vulnerability Database that actually has common vulnerabilities and exposures which are actually real attacks on web applications and technologies. All you need to know about this is that each common vulnerability and exposures comes with two things: the list of technologies it can affect and the expertise that you need to execute this. Now, for the attacker, we have different attacker types. Now, why do we have multiple types? So let's say you are a banking application and you store records of customers in your database. So you might have a higher probability that a database hacker will try to hack your account or your web application, versus let's say you are the owner of a blogger site. All people might try to do is just to get one web page down or remove content or modify content. So maybe they do not need a database hacker, but they can do with script hackers or script kiddies. So we have multiple attacker types, and each attacker type is denoted by a name, which is the ID, a expertise level of what expertise it has on a certain technology. It can have multiple expertise across multiple technologies, so that is a set, and you have a probability with which this attacker might attack your web application system. Now, how do we assign a CVE or an attack to an attacker? So it's very simple. If the technology that the CVE affects is same as the technology that the attacker has some expertise in, that's one. And two, if the attacker's expertise is greater than the expertise required to exploit the CVE. This is also the n theta vector for the theta attacker type, in which case n1 theta denotes the probability with which the attacker selects the first attack, and to theta with which it selects the second attack. Now the rewards. First I'll talk about the reward structures, and then we'll talk about how we got these rewards from a real system. So if an attacker, which is the top RA theta 2i, if an attacker of type I is able to execute an attack that affects the vulnerability of a system, then it gets a positive XA. If it gets caught, it gets a negative YA and zero otherwise. The defender in the same kind of paradigm gets minus XD if the attack affects his or her configuration, and plus YA if it can detect the attack. Now, how do we get realistic score for this kind of a cybersecurity system? So there is also something called the common vulnerability score, scoring system, in which all you need to know for now, you can obviously go ahead and read more in the paper, it has two high-level scores. One is the impact score, and the other is the exploitability score. And these two metrics can also be combined in a non-trivial way to form something called a base score. Now, these scores are assigned by security experts across the world, and all we do is give the defender a negative reward of the impact score from this score, and the attacker a positive reward of the base score. If we had given the attacker just the impact score, it would have been a zero-sum game. But we can't, because let's consider two attacks which have the same impact, but one of them is very easy to exploit, so the exploitability score is less. So the attacker would rather prefer to execute that action which gives him the same impact, but has much less exploitability score. So with that, we now have the formulation of a repeated Bayesian game. It's Bayesian because we have multiple attacker types. It's repeated because we want to take into account the strategy of the attacker, that it can see what strategy you're going to pull off and react to it. Now, what do we want? We essentially want a good strategy for the defender. So that would essentially be maximizing the reward of the defender, given the probability of the attacker types, the probability of using that configuration, and the probability with which a certain attack is used by an attacker. This is also the problem of finding a strong cycle-bug equilibrium in this repeated Bayesian game. But wait, it's not this simple. Because now, since you're considering web applications, switching between configuration isn't easy. Because let's say you want to switch from a database which was in MySQL to something which is in PostgreSQL. The problem is that all the requests that came in when you had your system up in MySQL has a different tuple than the system that will be running on PostgreSQL. Your read queries have to still be executable. So it's a non-trivial transfer. You have to do some backend transfer to do this. So there is some switching cost associated with each of this transfer. So let us say we model this switching cost to switch from configuration I to configuration J as Kij. So now your objective is not only to increase defender rewards, but also to minimize this cost. Now, if you notice this term, the term xi into xj denotes the probability of selecting configuration I in one step and then selecting configuration j in the next step. And kij would essentially denote the cost, so it's the expected cost over two steps. But there's bad news. Xi into xj makes this a bilinear mixed integer program, which is non-convex. So what can we do? We replace the variable xi into xj with a single variable, which is wij in this case, and we use some extra constraints, which are known as the McCormick envelope, and some constraints relevant to our problem. I won't be talking about all of this right now, but you can come and talk to me at the post if you really want to know. So moving on, this is one of the mock systems we made, and we actually have a code base that, given any mock system code in Python, MySQL, can convert the Python code into PHP and MySQL queries into PostgreSQL queries. So essentially, if you give me an application with just one code base, I generate you four of those. And with that, on the left top, I have switching cost for our system. If you notice that all the switching costs are symmetric in the first place, so it means if you are switching from PHP PostgreSQL to, say, Python PostgreSQL, it's the same as switching from Python PostgreSQL to PHP PostgreSQL. And the second table on the left denotes the attacker types. So apparently, this is a model given to us by a network administrator, but we plan to use some data mining techniques on the deep web, and we are coordinating with some security labs there to actually find a good distribution for this table. So here, I'll just explain one entry. Let's talk about the script kiddie. He has expertise in exploiting PHP applications with an expertise level of 4, and MySQL applications also with an expertise level of 4. 10 is the maximum you can go to. The probability of a script kiddie attacking your system is 0.15, and the number of attacks using the formula of if you have enough expertise, if you can exploit a CV, you'll end up getting 34 attack actions for this clip. So, as a result, previously cybersecurity systems was using uniform random strategy. If you use that strategy, the reward that the defender gets is -5. It gets a better reward with our algorithm. Also, an interesting thing to note is that even though a web application stack might have thousands of configurations, you might not land up using all of them. If you can see, the first two configurations are not being used. And if you use them, it will essentially land you up in a low security system. So this wasn't very trivial to the cybersecurity people. A problem that emerged when we did this is when we think of single stack web applications, we realize that when a question is asked to, say, a manager that what vulnerabilities should we fix in the system, all you have to do is find the most security vulnerable bugs and fix those. But now you have a system which has 4 stacks. So now addressing the question which bug you should fix in a system to take out an attack action is not a very trivial one. In fact, if you ask a more general game theoretic question, the question comes in that if one player is powerful enough to take away key attacks from another player, which key attacks would they choose to take out? So we don't have a good solution to this. We have a brute force approach in which you select all the NCK attack sets, remove them from the optimization problem, find out the optimization value. As you can understand, it takes a lot of time. Now, one thing would be that if this had a substructure, like knowing the K-1 critical set, you could find the K set. But that substructure, unfortunately, doesn't exist. This example doesn't show it, but we have some extra results on an archive version of the same paper. But we are thinking of introducing some switch variables into the optimization problem, only K of which can be turned on or turned off, so that those attacks are not encountered in the optimization problem. But the only problem to that is that using the switch variable needs a multiplication with the probability variable of the attack, and that creates a bilinear non-convex in the attacker dual. I would be happy to talk to you about this later. So in conclusion, we talk about moving target defense in cybersecurity systems. We formulate this as a repeated Bayesian game. We show that stackable bug equilibrium would ideally give you the best strategy for the defender, but you also have to account for switching costs. And you can read our paper for more details on these things. With that, I'll conclude my presentation. Thanks a lot.
Questions? So I can start with one question. You talk about the repeated game. So what do you mean by the stage? I guess it's like the attacker defender, they have to follow some protocol. Like every day you have a switch, or well, how about if the attacker is not following?
That is actually a very good question. And we haven't addressed it in the paper, but the question of when, what is the time after you which you should switch is a non-trivial one. That's one. And the second thing is that generally, if you're talking about exploits, you need to make a certain amount of queries and a certain amount of time to figure it out. So let's say if an attacker needs, say, 4 hours to figure it out, then your switching time should be less or greater. So there is some investigation we are doing there that considering the CVs that are there out in the world, what is the time for finding the right actual set of commands and actual time to execute it, how much long does it take for white hat attackers, and then figuring out the switching time. We don't have a switching time in this game.
Okay, I think that's why sometimes it might be a better idea to treat that as a one-shot game, but we try to randomize.
The only reason we use this as a repeated game was because that your web application is not going to be out there only for a day, hopefully. So if it's out there for a longer time, then the attacker would surely figure out your strategy in some time. And after that, you still need to optimize for it. So that is why we formulated this algorithm.
Yes.
So very good presentation.
Thank you.
So the question I have is, you could have multiple attackers attacking at the same time, right?
Yes.
And at that time, can you change the configurations at runtime based on the IP of the attacker? You know, in this case, you'll have, if you have four different configurations based on the IP, you could even do better.
Actually, that is very true. There are two things. I cheated in the presentation a little. One is, I did not consider the cases when the defender gets positive reward and the attacker gets negative reward, in which cases they are actually caught. Because in cybersecurity systems, it's very difficult to actually identify an attack when it was being executed. And you generally identify it once it's done. So that is the part it's very hard to actually find out that an attack is going on. So the thing you're saying, that realizing it's going on and now doing a switching, is not a very trivial problem, even for cybersecurity. Forget AI. The other second part is, you raise a very interesting question. Could there be a good effective teaming of attackers that can actually hit your web application in such a way, say for denial of service attacks? So that is something that is also not trivial for game theory. I haven't seen much literature which actually tries to couple different types and actually incorporate them. Maybe we can compile it down to a bigger game which actually considers possible players with probabilities or something like that and try to do it, but we haven't done this for this one.
So can you ask that offline? So let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.
Well, that's the end of this session. So we can have lunch now. Enjoy your lunch. And then